So essentially, this is all about breaking barriers, right? And I have a set of what I call structured slides, but I won't talk through that. But I'll talk to you about one incident in my life where I had to break a barrier, right? I had a good six-figure salary job in 1988 in the Valley, okay? Had a great house, great pool, and all that kind of things, lovely cars, and I decided to become an entrepreneur. Wonderful. So it was tough. Everything is not easy. But what happened to me was a combination of events. My second child was diagnosed with something called myocarditis, and when I took him to Stanford Medical School Hospital, they ruptured his heart. He went into coma. Not a lot of people know this. And I had given up my job. I was doing a startup. I had a child who was impaired severely because there was no kind of way out of that. And then the insurance company came after me and said, you got to pay $1 million. So before I started, I was already in the hole. 9 years later, I was able to build this company, my first company, and it was incredibly successful. We sold it to BEA, okay? During this journey, I also met Radhanath Swami. I think we had one speaker mention him earlier. He's a great friend. All Babaji's, Guruji's are good friends. I don't follow them, but I spend time. But I had to rely on friends. I had to rely on the extended family. I had to rely on my employees. Otherwise, it would not be possible. So after spending time with about 300 companies that I have actually funded or being associated with in the last so many years, I thought I'll put some structure. But remember, okay, it's not an easy journey. You have to be disciplined. Now, there's one. Can you guys read this? How many of you like music? Right? How many of you have heard of this group called Steely Dan? Lovely. So that's from there, okay? So let's just go. So the journey, right? Everyone wants to be an entrepreneur. Everyone wants to do something, right? But very few people understand the market. Not a lot of people want to change unless something happens. So you have to be an evangelist. Things have to. So it's very important to understand the market. What is your idea? Okay? The idea should typically be very, very simple. Okay? And you should be able to create some kind of traction. When I say traction, in and around yourself, right? So we had Mr. Nirmal talk this morning. He was able to create some traction. He saw something. But the same thing, if you had tried in India, it would have been very, very difficult, I can tell you. So you got to understand the environment. You got to understand where there's traction, and then you got to build it out, right? So what works in the U.S. may not work here, right? How many of you people know what's the difference between Ola and Uber? Lovely, lovely. So not that. Actually, it's the origin. If you look at Uber, it was truly a shared economy product. Because if you look at the number of vehicles per capita in the U.S., it's 70% privately owned vehicles. And the utilization is 10%. So there was a motivation, there was a need for shared economy where you could actually kind of share your car and earn money. India is exactly the opposite, right? India, private vehicles is about 2%. And I can tell you, 99% of those 2% will never do the sharing. They love sitting alone in a big car and driving, right? So very, very opposite ends of the spectrum. The second thing is we don't have a license to operate our private cars as a taxi, right? So Ola started to kind of aggregate small taxi operators. Eventually, both the worlds came together because when Uber arrived in India, they were faced with the same reality. So Uber and Ola in India is exactly the same now, or very close. So when Ola is going to U.K., now they actually open up a very different kind of business model, and they will do well. That's also a company I was part of because I'd invested in a company called TFS, which got acquired by Ola. So we are shareholders there too. Hopefully, something good will happen. So if you look at this, right? So U.S., China, India are all very different. We keep talking about the next 100 million people coming on board and we can actually build a business. It is not the case because India is not homogeneous. China has one language, no religion. US is pretty much one language, standard infrastructure, standard buying patterns, maybe people spend a little bit less or more. India is not like that. The next 100 million is actually made up of $25 million sets, each of which is different. So if you were to say, okay, how many people are there in Ranchi who earn 10 lakhs, 12 lakhs, they'll behave this way compared to, say, in Calcutta? Very, very different behavior. You might be thinking demographics in terms of big numbers, but you have to actually focus, right? So that is one thing which you should know. If you're doing anything in India, it is going to be tough, right? So whether it's a B2C business, you're selling to consumers directly, or you're selling to businesses, you have to think. And this is where I would say 90% of the entrepreneurs make mistakes. They think of an idea, wake up in the morning and say, I'm going to go. 2 years later, they're thinking differently. Okay, the idea itself should be a clear value proposition. Everyone should relate to it. Okay, if they're not able to relate to it and it's a little complicated, it becomes tougher to sell. Because then you have to do evangelical selling. It has to be something, like for example, Ola was good because it was a perishable, everyone wanted to travel, it became popular, right? Or Big Basket, which is another one of our thing, was actually much more challenging because India doesn't change that easily. No one wanted to buy groceries online. That journey for that team took like 8 years. Today they are a billion-dollar valued company, whereas Ola has already been valued at 10 billion, right? These are the things, right, where you have to really be very, very practical and realistic when you're actually kind of building a company. So simplicity, easy to articulate. Are you unique or are you enabling disruption? Which means, are you doing something very, very different, right, to the landscape? Then the market, a lot of people get this wrong, right? What is your total addressable market? What is your specific addressable market? And what is your serviceable market? You have to be very practical. And these numbers have to be fairly large for your idea to be funded by an investor. If it is not large and you're building what is called a lifestyle company, that's also okay. But these are things that you need to kind of at least put in the back of your mind before you actually take the journey, right? And of course, look at competition, look at everything. A lot of people don't even do that. They just go out. And then suddenly they get screwed by competition, right? So then market plus the idea, okay? You have to come up with this, what is called the minimum viable product. What is a minimum viable product? Something which you can launch, figure out if it's working, pull back, change. If you start building something which is huge, it'll continue to keep on going. And you will actually at some stage figure out, where did I start, where am I going to end, right? And can you do it alone? My thesis is you can never build a company alone. Those days are over, right? I did it with my first company, I was slightly lucky, but the world is not that way. So get yourself a good founding team who complement you. They shouldn't emulate you. There shouldn't be too much overlap, right? So that you are learning from each other. That's very, very important, right? Then it's very important for you to be disciplined. Now, I talk about creativity, innovation, etc. That is necessary for you to be an entrepreneur. You've already made that decision. But once you start the journey, never forget metrics, which is early customer feedback, mentor reviews, get a bunch of mentors in, bounce ideas so that they can actually critique you, potential friendly angel reviews. So someone like me, I spend a lot of time with young entrepreneurs to say, okay, I don't like this idea because I can't fund it. Go rethink it. And sometimes these interactions last for 2, 3 years, 4 years, whatever, right? And then establish clear gates for success. What do you think is success? Not what other people think, right? And never forget that. A lot of people. So what I'm trying to say is, like, while there's a lot of innovation, creativity, ideas, technology, if you're not disciplined, right? If you're not disciplined, you'll never get to the next level. And I call it the S curves, right? You know how an S is this way. I'm just drawing an S this way. Every company goes through a peak, tapers off. So if you do a sigma of it, it'll be a sigma of several S curves that you have to go through. Early stage, next stage, what is it that you need for series A? What is it that you need for series B? Like, there's a lovely company, how am I doing for time? I'm okay? No. So there's a lovely company called Nephro Plus. How many of you have heard of Nephro Plus? Okay. It was basically getting affordable kidney kind of patient care to the masses. So today, they are basically at 2,000 outlets. All it is was he kind of optimized the process, got like cheaper machines, and started charging patients at an appropriate point where they could actually pay, including coverage by insurance. There's several such ideas in India. And everything doesn't have to be software or some really great idea like AI, machine learning, or blockchain. But like these businesses are the backbone of India. And we fund that also. So I don't look at, basically, is it pure tech or is it non-tech? If there is an impact, which is what India needs, you have to have impactful businesses that are being started, which impact everyone. And if you do it well here, you'll do it well anywhere else. Because the other emerging markets are a lot more homogeneous, right? So, the traction, right? It's very important that you have a set of very faithful fan following or customers. If you have done that, you've done something immensely valuable. Because they come back, they give you such lovely feedback, and they also tell you if you're being stupid, right? It's very important. Again, every time you're going out to the market, refactor. Again, my mantra is simplicity. Try to keep it as simple, because that's what gets you to be accepted easily, right? Hygiene. A lot of entrepreneurs that I know do not pay attention to this. They might come and talk about ethics and all that, but they aren't even aware of their cash flow. If you don't have cash flow, you don't have a business. It'll not survive. So these things are very important to me when I'm actually going and funding, because if I'm giving you money or you're taking money from somewhere else, it is someone else's money. So you have to be disciplined, right? And then some amount of marketing has to be put, which may be as part of your next journey, but you should do that. So you will kind of spend some, right? And then you start to kind of have informal conversations with a whole bunch of seed and angel investors, because they'll also give you inputs. Now, how long is this journey? It can be anywhere from when you had your idea till this point. It could be 18 months. It could be even 3 years. But don't lose heart, right? So I won't go through this because these are slides available which you guys can actually take a look at. But I'll leave you with one. It's done. So these are some of the things, right? I look at the thesis as two things, right? What are we doing as an investor? In the next 100 million consumers in India. So I nurture. What does it do? It actually takes education, next generation education, to tier two, tier three cities through colleges and technology. Boombox. It allows people in rural India to actually start buying stuff and use EMIs as a way to. So it could be TVs, it could be mobile phones, it could be kitchen appliances, etc. Right? If you look at Bog Orchard, that's basically a very interesting company which is coming up with an organic way to reduce or kill mosquitoes. So it can be put in any of the common areas, right? Then if you look at credit, on EMI, this is financial inclusion for people who don't have credit. So how do you use machine learning, AI, data to actually, so these are some examples, right? I'll skip this one. So basically at the end, I want to leave, this is the last slide. The end goal, make it happen, no matter what, right? It's a hard journey. It's a very hard journey. And this is a t-shirt, which is a derivative of Steely Dan, since Nirmal, so this is it too. Again. So every time you're scared, remember there's a new day, and never give up. That's about it. Thank you.